Welcome to the next session. Our next speaker is Grace Kumar.
Hello.
Hi, Grace Kumar. So where are you from?
I'm from Bangalore, India.
Oh, very nice. Yeah, so it's very far from me. I'm from Switzerland here. So I see you are talking about type checks in Django, so type hints. So I'm looking forward to that. And some important thing, if you have questions, please use the chat again in the Conference 3 Need channel. And at the end, we can come to the Q&A session. Okay, let's start.
Welcome to my EuroPython talk, TypeCheck Django app. Who am I? I'm a software engineer based out of Bangalore. I'm Grace Kumar. For the course of the talk, I will talk about recently introduced gradual typing in Python, very specifically for Django. Throughout this talk, all the examples are recorded using a latest version of Django 3.2, and I'm the static type checker used is MyPy. Now, types at runtime. Python is a dynamically typed language, so while you're creating a variable or creating a function, there is no need to specify the types of the input and output. So to find the types, but still behind the scenes, Python data holder and every expression has its own type. So by default, Python interpreter has this method called type, where when you pass in a data holder, it returns the type. Here is a small example. Type function takes a tuple of two elements. First element is an IP address of the string type. The second one is an integer. And the type function returns the output as tuple. Here is a user object, Django inbuilt user object. And the result of the filter is passed on to it. And the type function returns a query set. Static checker type. Similar to type, MyPy, Python is static type checker has got a inbuilt method called reveal type. So here we have a tuple, address, and port as its elements. When you pass it to reveal type, the type is revealed as a tuple, but it goes one level deep and also specifies the types of the elements, that is string and integer. Same thing, now we are passing output of the user manager's filter method. The reveal type says it's a user manager of user. As noted, like the reveal type is much more in depth. It goes one level deep and tries to find the elements as well. This is the difference between the dynamic behavior at runtime and the static typing behavior. So MyPy has a configuration file. So since Django app does not contain default type hints, we need to add certain information to MyPy config so that MyPy can understand the custom types of Django. The first thing is for the course of the talk and to work with Django, we need to use a third-party library called Django Stubs, which is maintained by an organization called Type Django. So first we need to mention that MyPy can find the custom entry point for Django in this plugin called MyPy Django plugin. Once we mention that, then the whatever settings that plugin needs, we mention it in a different section, that is mypy.plugins.django-stubs. And here to work with Django app, we need to mention the Django settings. Once you mention these two pieces of information, then MyPy static type checker can internally figure out what are the types being used. For example, what is the request type? What is the response type? What is the user manager type? All those details can be inferred using this settings file. Annotation syntax. So how do you annotate a piece of code in Python? So you have a variable name separated by colon, and you specify the type of that variable, then the value. Here lang colon string specifies the language variable is of type string. Year colon date says year variable is of type date. The same syntax follows for a function or for a method. So here is a function called sum, which takes in two arguments, a and b, and both is of type integer. A colon int, b colon int specifies it's an integer, and the return type is integer. We are using arrow to specify the return type. Similar example we have for initializer for the class person. Self, since self you don't need to annotate. Name is of type string. Age is of type integer. Is alive is of type boolean. Since initializer does not return any value, there's no need to annotate the return. writing Django code. Let's start with simple view function. We have view function index, returns a response. So always a view function takes a HTTP request and returns a HTTP response. HTTP response can be of multiple subtypes. Let's see an example of that. Here is a simple view function which returns HTTP response not found. There are three different ways to annotate the same function. The input argument is same HTTP request, but the output can be annotated three different ways. In the first example, we say the HTTP response. The second example, we say HTTP response not found. In third, we say it as object. So now MyPy, according to MyPy, all three are valid return types. Now we will say how MyPy is able to understand these three different types, these different classes, and not complaining they are not exactly the same. So every class has got this method resolution order. Method resolution order returns the order in which from child class to the parent class hierarchy. For example, HTTP response inherits HTTP response base. HTTP response base internally inherits object. Now there's another example, HTTP response not found. HTTP response not found inheriting HTTP response. And HTTP response inherits HTTP response base and object. Since HTTP response not found is a special case of all these three cases, MyPy did not complain because they are part of the same inheritance chain. So this principle is called Liskov substitution principle. According to Liskov substitution principle, that an object-oriented program substituting a superclass object reference with an object of any of its subclasses, the program should not break. Next is Django models. Create method. Here is a simple model question which has got two explicit fields. The first one is a question text of character field. Second one, pub date of date time field. Here is a helper method create question which takes in a question text and returns a question instance. This is like a simple way to create a question object. Next is a read. To get an object from the database, we normally use a filter method or a get method. Here we have used a filter method. Here is a method, here is a function called getQuestion, which takes in a question text and returns a question. It uses filter internally. It does question.objects.filter and dot first. Now when you run this code against MyPy, MyPy complains that incompatible return value type. So it's saying like the question, what is annotated as a return type is incompatible. Let's see what it says. Optional of any expected question. So what this says is like the function that is annotated to return question, but it is possible that it can return optional of any. So what is optional here means none. If we know the internals of first, whenever the value is found, then only the first would return an instance, else it will return none. So MyPy is able to catch that error that this particular implementation can return none. Even though you can be confident that this question text exists in database, but it is technically possible that it can return a none value. So MyPy is warning that it is possible that you are missing the none condition here. How do we fix this? There are two ways. The first way is to go say that to the type checker that, hey, now I'm changing it to optional of question. That means this function can return none or instance of question. Second way is to control the config of MyPy and tell MyPy not to complain when optional is returned. So here is a simple example, strict underscore optional. So MyPy works in a two different modes, that is strict mode or lenient mode. Whenever you want none to be skipped, you can say strict underscore optional is equal to false. Now when you annotate it to return question, MyPy internally understands that if it is possible to return none, but I will not complain when none is returned. Next is filter method. So questions.objects.all returns a query set of questions. Same thing, when you do a questions.objects.filter returns a query set of question. That is, query set always carries an empty either an empty query set or a query set with models. So query set cannot work alone. So query set is a box type. Whenever it is carrying an items inside it, all of the items will be of the same type, that is of same model. Here is a simple example, query sets.objects.filter and objects.exclude. You say query set of question. So of, how do you say it is of? It's like use a square brackets to mention that outer type contains the inner type. Here the outer type is query set and the inner type is question. Some other methods will return query set, alt, reverse, etc. Now let's see aggregate function. Aggregate functions, before getting into the code, let's see two models. Here we have two models. One is a publisher model, which has got an explicit field name. Another is a book model, which has got six explicit fields. Name is of type character field, page of integer field, price is of decimal field, rating is of float field, publisher is of foreign key to publisher model, pubdate is a date field. Now here we have a function called getAverageProice. So what it does is it does average SQL aggregate function all the books present in the book table. So average underscore price is equal to AVG of price, where you mentioned the price is the column name, the value will be contained in the average price variable. So if you run this query, you can see the result to be in a dictionary, average price as a key, the value in a decimal. Now how do we annotate this? We know the return type is going to be dictionary, so we can say the dictionary. We need to specify the type of the key and values type. We know the type of the key is going to be string, and we know the values type is going to be decimal. So we say dict of str comma decimal. Always keys type will come first, values type will come second. Next is annotate method. Now we have a function called count by publisher here. Now we wanted to do is we wanted to count the books published by publisher. For example, if it's a Penguin, we want to specify how many books Penguin has published. If it's Vintage, how many books has Vintage published. So what we are going to do, we are going to use annotate method. So annotate dot numbooks is equal to count of books. So which will say like it will group the publisher by name and return the number of books returned by the publisher, and it is going to return dot values. Okay. Now if you see the output, it looks something like this, a list of dictionary, because there are more than one publisher present, and each key has got so the dictionary like structure has got two keys. One is name, other is num underscore books. Now if you remove dot values, then what happens is annotate returns a query. Now count by publisher is not only returning name and num books, rather it returns a query set. Now there is a one more function called print underscore pub, which consumes the count by publisher. There are two blocks here. First is if else block, second part is for loop. The if block, in the num books is value is passed, the returned result from the count by publisher is further filtered. And any publisher which matches the number of books or greater than the number of books, only those results are returned. In the for loop, we print the name and the num books, right? Now let's try to annotate these two functions, very specifically count by publisher, and see what MyPy says to us. If you see the output, it works as expected: name of the publisher, number of books. So this is a legit code. Excuse me. Since we saw this output looks like a dictionary, so what we can do is we can actually annotate the output to look like a dictionary. Since we know the keys are static, that we only know it's going to contain two keys and what are those values, so we can use something called typedict. So typedict helps us to annotate when there are more than one keys in the dictionary, and when the key and values types are known in advance. Right. In our case, we know it is going to be name, which is of type string, num books of type integer, and we give a name called a published book count. Right. Now, since there is going to be more than one result, we are going to say it's iterable, since we are using a for loop. So it is understood that iterable is a valid type. So iterable or published book count. Now let's see what does MyPy say about this annotation. Now MyPy complains with two errors. The first it says, at line number 46, that is wherever we are annotating, say, count by publisher, it says that you are saying it is iterable or published book count, but it is supposed to return, it is returning query set of any. That means like it, annotate is returning query set of any, but you are saying it returns iterable or published book count. And further inside that for loop, it is saying, Either Rebel or published book code has no attribute filter. It is like inside the if block, if you see, there is a filter with the further, right? So now there are two valid. Yes, definitely these are valid. Now how do we fix this? Since MyPy is confident that it is saying its query set of any, let's try to annotate this as query set of publisher. Now, once you annotate that as query set of publisher and run this against MyPy, now MyPy says, okay, first error gone, that it, so it's correct. Right now, publisher has no attribute num underscore books. If you look at the if you remember from the previous slides, publisher had only one explicit attribute called name. Num books attribute was not declared in the model. Since it's an annotate method, Django dynamically adds this attribute num underscore books in the return result, and because of that, because of the dynamic Django behavior, MyPy is unable to understand how this num underscore books was added to the result. This is a valid use case because there is nowhere in the Django declaration that num underscore books was present. Oh, how do we fix this? This is actually a bug in Django because annotate method, since it can add values to the result at runtime, it is not possible to annotate properly. So, but there is a workaround for this. From typing module, import type checking, and you can use this if type checking block to declare certain type of types, which is available only for MyPy and not available during Python runtime. So here what we are doing, we are creating a new type called type publisher, which inherits from publisher first thing. So we have the name order. Now we are creating a new field called num underscore books, which is of type integer field. And third, we are saying it abstract is equal to true. Right? Now this type checker, now while type checking block is executed, now the type publisher is available to MyPy. So what we are going and doing is like convey publisher now returns query set of type publisher. Query set, as I said earlier, can only contain instance of the model. So type publisher inherits publisher. So it will be an instance of the model. So it will not comply. Now let's go back to the if block. Since if block contains like a filter method works on the query set. Yes, that condition is satisfied. Now let's go to the for block. In for block, we have dot name. Yes, type publisher has got dot name, right? Now numbooks has got numbook is declared in type publisher. Yes. Now MyPy will not complain that these fields are missing. Okay. Now that we have seen some of the ways to annotate Django code. Now, it is not always possible to annotate source code from the beginning. So there are some tools which can help you to get from zero to some position, and then you can manually add titles. I'm going to speak about one such tool. This is called PyAnnotate. PyAnnotate, what it does is like while running the Python program, it can infer the types at runtime, and it can convert the runtime types into static time types. There's a plugin called PyTest Annotate, which can infer types during test execution and can write it to a file, and later you can use those annotations to annotate your code. So I'll show an example. So here is a sample Django code. It has got two views. There is no annotation for request and response. Now you have some test case like this where you set up a test factory and then you make a HTTP call, and then there is some kind of a response. Here in this code, there is no assertion, but in general, there will be some sort of assertion. Now that you have a source code, now that you have a test code, now you can actually run the PyTest plugin with extra option called annotate output. This implies that you already installed PyTest annotate, and then you can pass this extra argument called annotate output and the file location. Once you do this, at the end of the test, you can see a file like this where each and it contains a list of dictionaries where each dictionary represents type annotation for a single data holder, which could be a Python function or a method, or it can be lambda expression, whatever it is. So the structure is similar, which has got a path. What is the line number? What is the function name? What is the type declaration? How many samples did this test case use? Now that you have annotation, now you can apply these annotations to this source file. You can run pyannotate CLI and say the type information is available in annotations.py file, and you add type annotations to this particular file called pol/views.py. Use Python 3 syntax. Now what would happen is, if the type hints are missing, then pyannotate will automatically add types to each of the available code paths. For example, in our case, there are only two view functions. It has added request as WSGI request, response or HTTP response. You can see that view function 404_0, it added HTTP response not found, and the imports are automatically added, though there it is not smart of importing HTTP response and response not found from the same module. It has got two lines for it. As you can also see that there's a drawback that WSGI request is annotated as WSGI request. Since this is a drawback, how Django tests are run, it is not actually HTTP request you make while testing the code, it's actually a WSGI request. Because of that, it is adding it as a WSGI request, but in general, you can replace it to be HTTP request. Now some learning resources. Since gradual typing is new and it is evolving, there are not much resources to learn gradual typing. So I've come up with a project called Python Typing Kaons. So what does this Python Typing Kaons do? Is it is a GitHub repository which contains various examples for learning concepts related to gradual typing. The code is organized into three structures. One is Python, other is Django, other is DRF. Once you clone the repository and run the summary, it gives list of all the files which don't have annotations, where annotations are missing. As a learner, you open one of the file and start editing the annotations and then run this file. Here is an output from one such file. So here you have a file called 103 model managers.py, and when you run against the static type checker, it says like there are three errors, and you can see the error. First one, it says missing type parameter for generic type query set. Now the function is missing a return type annotation. Now as a learner, what you would do is you'll go through the source code and you will start adding type hints for all the data holders like variables, methods, attributes, functions, all the expressions. And then what you would do, you would again run this command and you would see the errors. Now when the error moves from 3 to 0, that means you have solved all the errors. Now you can be confident that you have some understanding of how gradual typing works in Python in very specific concept as well. So there are around like the 25 examples, and you can go through one by one, and the difficulty level is there in the file name. Medium here says that difficulty level is medium. So you, over the course of time, you can see from easy you go to medium, and you will learn the type concepts in gradual typing. That's it. Thank you for attending my talk. In case if you like to contact me, you can contact me in Twitter. I'm Chris the King in Twitter. Have a good day. Bye.
Thank you very much for your talk. I have one first question. Is it possible to use type hints for lists with different data types? For example, hello, 3.145 world. Oh, there's a type on here.
right. Definitely it is possible to use. There are two ways to annotate. One is a union type, which can say like union of string, union of float, and integers. That is one way. Second way is to say any. But by default, since it's a gradual typing, all variables will have a default type any. So it depends on the use case. I would prefer using a union type, which will be explicitly saying only A, B, C types are allowed to in this particular list.
Okay. At the moment, there are not more questions. So I don't see in chat if someone... Sometimes you have to give people a little bit time for questions.
Sure. And sorry for the technical internet issues.
No problem. That's that's what's really funny about live conferences. These right, things right. have to happen, so it's more realistic and more fun than, I mean, we could just watch YouTube videos, that would be really boring. Okay, I see someone is typing. So let's just wait a bit.
Sure.
Okay, we actually do have a question. 1 second. Okay. So the question is, which is the best way to start a Django project with type annotation?
Okay, this looks harder. Which is the best way to start Django project with type annotation? What does this mean? So if you are starting a new project, I would say start with type annotation. So it will give you a meaningful work, but you have to also take in the consideration, like, is it a pet project or is it something, a big project, or is it only a prototype? That is one. Second thing is start using Django stubs. That can help you get started. First, try to cover the the breadth. Try to annotate as much as possible. Later, you can move on for the very precise definitions, like from strict mode versus lenient mode. So that could be the approach I would suggest.
Okay, so at the moment there are not more questions. So let me thank you again for this talk. And maybe one more question will pop up in the chat, so I hope you will be around there.
And sure.
Yeah, we can take a small break and then we will come to the next talk. Thank you.
Okay, thank you. It was great talking. Okay.